talte Hans Otto Bisgaard med forsangeren Ian Gillan.
This has been one of the most enjoyable tours I've ever done with the band. It's been fantastic. We've had a great time. The thing that stuns me always when I come back into Purple, this is the third time now, is you know, what great musicians the guys are. It's wonderful hearing John Lord and Ian and Roger playing so good, you know.
Yeah, but it is an extraordinary situation. You're back in a band you've been leaving two times.
Well, yeah, once voluntarily, the second time I was fired. I look on Deep Purple now as an ex-wife, you know, we've been married twice and divorced twice, and so from time to time we meet up and have wonderful affairs.
Yeah, but I think it shows also a positive situation. Mm. I mean, that you're able to go back and make things work. I mean,
I think the pressures that you have after the initial bout of success, you tend to have self-imposed pressures. You're looking over your shoulder all the time saying, my God, you know, this better be as good as, for example, Machine Head or those records we did in the 70s. And I think to a certain extent you get to a point where you think, well, you know, the race is over now, let's just enjoy ourselves. This is the point. And all the politics and the dramas that go down over the years, it's just a waste of time, really. I mean, the idea is to really put everything you've got into every project you've got. Purple used to dominate my whole life, and it took a long time to find a way of dealing with it, the perspective of it all, you know. And so I think of Purple now as part of my life, not all of my life. And when it happens, and it's wonderful.
Something I'd like to show you.
Is this going to be embarrassing?
No, I don't think so.
Nice wiggle.
They call Highway Star. Get on now.
Still playing that Rickenbacker.
Nobody gonna take my car, I'm gonna race it to the ground. Nobody gonna beat my car, I'm gonna break the
I don't think you'll remember that particularly night, but you'll remember the band, of course, the original lineup.
Yeah.
It's Copenhagen 72.
72?
Yeah. Only a mile away from here.
Yeah.
Copenhagen.
Yes. Yeah, I remember.
Yes. And you're saying there that this song will remain our opening number for a year or so.
Yeah, well, you know. There it is still now. But there are certain things that do change and certain things that don't change. For example, Smoke on the Water is still the closing song. And Highway Star is still the opening song. But in between, there's a lot of changes, you know. For example, we didn't do... I haven't sung Child in Time for a long time, but Child in Time is now back in the show because of its relevance to some of the new songs we do, like Anya and The Battle Rages On. There are some things that you just can't escape from. I think if we went away without doing Smoke on the Water, we'd get lynched anyway, so... And I don't know, I came back into this, and I guess it's become part of Purple's tradition now to open with that song, you know. I don't know if we always will, but it has been for quite a while now.
take my car, I'm gonna race it to the ground. Nobody gonna beat my car, I'm gonna break the speed sound. Oh, it's a killer machine, it got everything. Like a driving power, big fat tires and everything. I love it, and I need it, I feel it. Yeah, it's a wild hurricane, all right, hold tight. Gonna take my girl, I'm gonna keep her to the end. Nobody gonna take my girl today, clothes on every bed. Oh, she's a killer machine, she got everything. Like a moving lips, body controlling everything. I love her, I need her, I feel her. Yeah, she turned me on, alright, hold tight.
I certainly think everyone actually plays better now than they used to. I mean, but that comes with practice, I guess. So it's just a question of bringing in new material. Even in those days, you know, when we'd done about 15 or 20 shows on a tour, the band used to get tired. Not physically tired, but the show used to get tired. And so there was always pressure to change the act around a little bit or bring some improvisation into the show. And you're constantly aware of the fact that each show you do, even though it might be your 50th show on the tour, it's the first night for the people in the audience. So you've got to be fresh for it, and you've got to be alive for it. And so there's ways of stimulating yourself, you know. I mean, in the old days, it used to be probably through one or two too many Scotch and Cokes, but, I mean, nowadays we look on things differently.
Is that one of the reasons why you survived? Do you think that you've become that more clever?
I don't know about clever. It's more streetwise, I think, is what you do. And experience, you know, is a great thing. You really do learn to make things seem a little bit more, you know. I think it's like watching, if you watch a good musician and it seems effortless, it's like watching a good football player. And it, I mean, I stumble around on the field trying to imitate other players, but there's no way I can do it. But they've been doing it all their life, professional players. They practice and make the hard things look easy. And those are the skills, I think, of being on the road for a long time.
What made rock go hard rock, you think?
It's a combination of things. I think probably we found our feet as writers, for a start off. We weren't copying other people's songs. And we'd all been around for a few years. And after the Beatles and Bob Dylan, etc., everyone started working on writing their own material. Then, of course, Jimi Hendrix came along, Vanilla Fudge, people like that. And most British artists up until that time had been still a little bit constrained. It was a natural British trait to sort of not let yourself entirely go, you know. I think that suddenly we found that we could become uninhibited. And so we let loose all this years of pent-up emotion and energy, and suddenly it went the other way. And with a newfound confidence, plus, again, a certain amount of experience. With Purple, certainly, it was a question of two units blending together. There was Ritchie, John and Ian, who'd already been together with the original Purple lineup with Rod Evans and Nick Simper. And Rog and I joined from another band, and so we came in not as individuals, but almost as a unit. Me as a singer, him as a bass player, but as a writing team. So we were there delivering tunes and words together. So it was, the chemistry was quite easy to work out. It was just two units blending together. And all that gives you confidence, and with confidence you've got everything.
What do you think made the term hard rock? Was it just a matter
of... like you.
Yeah. You never thought of it within the band you just played?
Do you know, we were called underground rock, progressive rock, yeah. Hard rock was just another one of those names, and I think the press picks up on things as later years, you know, heavy metal and all that sort of thing. It's not the sort of thing that musicians set out to describe themselves as. You don't set out to describe, we never did anyway. We didn't want to be a certain kind of band. Most bands would like to have the identity afforded to individual artists, solo artists. They would like to be perceived as being a living, creative, moving, procreative thing. But it's very difficult. With bands, they kind of get locked into the labels and you're pigeonholed then forever, really. And you have to fight very hard to create a new perception. If you're a solo artist, you can do a bit of this and a bit of that. We found after Deep Purple in Rock, we did a thing called Fireball, which is my personal favorite record that Purple ever made. But people freaked out. They said, no, you've got to be a hard rock band. So we came back and did Machine Head, which was back on the road again. And that's what people seem to like. So I think we go and explore the countryside from time to time, but every now and again, you've got to get back on the freeway.
This is one of the older ones we used to do. It's a song about a man who was a friend of ours, and it's also a true story. This fella's mixed up with this really evil bird, you know, and his, she gives him a hard time, they get married, and a few days later she dies. And this is the story of it. We'd like to tell you now. A song called Strange Kind of Woman, this one. There once was a woman, a strange kind of woman, the kind that gets written down in history. Her name was an answer, a face with a fancy. She left a trail of happiness and misery. Everybody loved her. She loved her, everyone, and gave a good return. I tried to take her, I even tried to break her. She said, I ain't for taking, won't you ever learn? I want you, I need you, I gotta be near you. I spent my money and I took my own. I want you, I need you, I gotta be near you. Ooh, got a strange kind of woman, yeah. She looked like a raver, but I could never please her. Wednesday morning, boy, you can't go far. I couldn't get her, but things got better. She said, Saturday night from now, baby, you're my star. I want you, I need you, I gotta be near you. I spent my money and it's my turn. I want you, I need you, I gotta be near you. Ooh, got a strange kind of woman.
It's incredible, Ian, that what you and the band started out have influenced so many bands later on.
Yes. I've had it said many times, yeah. You know, that Purple was a great influence. But I think if you look at that period, there were two or three bands that were of enormous influence over the years. Purple was one, certainly. Zeppelin, obviously. Black Sabbath. I think if you listen to the grunge stuff coming out of Seattle over the last year, and then go and play some old Tony Iommi licks, you'll find an awful lot of similarity. Free, of course, were another band that influenced people over the years. But I think it goes to show the diversity of the influences that were there during our formative years. Everything from American pop music, blues, folk music, jazz, country and western. And then, of course, when the keyboard players started getting involved, you got the classical influence, and the whole thing was just an amalgam of all the things that had frustrated us and influenced us over the years. And then as times went on, you got reggae and other forms of influence coming, Latin American music. And all of these things just exploded to make rock music something that I really thought would never die. You know? And I think to this very moment in my life that even though it's been through some wobbly stages, it's still very much alive. We've just finishing this tour now in Scandinavia, and it's been the most sensational audiences. And I think most of the average age has been under 25 years. And that's very encouraging for the future.
Sweet child in time, you'll see the line, the line that's drawn between the good and the bad. See the blind man, he's shooting at the world, the bullets flying. Taking toll. If you've been bad, Lord, I bet you have, and you've not been hit by flying lead. You'd better close your eyes, you'd better bow your head. Wait for ricochet. I'm crying for you day and night.
Going back to this concert in Copenhagen in 73, in Metallica there's a Danish drummer, Lars Ulrich. Mm. You know about Metallica, I guess.
Yeah, I know the guys.
Yeah. That was his first.
Lars, yeah.
Yes, that was his first rock concert ever.
Was it really?
Yes, it was. Mm. And Fireball was his first rock album, mm. first album he ever bought. I mean, that's just to name one that started here.
I went to see Metallica in Munich at the Olympic Hall in Munich, well, it doesn't seem long ago, about a year ago now, while we were recording The Battle Rages On, and it was a great show. Yes, it's nice to hear. It makes you feel kind of as if you've been around forever, you know, but there you are, still trying to write new things and still trying to be involved in something that has some relationship to your reaction with life, you know.
Right, but there you also are now, Ian, with heavy competition. I mean, going back to there, I mean, you were up there in rock, no doubt about it. Mm. But today there's, I mean, bands sneaking in on you.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. That was a time that was very special, and that was our time. And I think probably one of the great values is that the music has stood the test of time. I mean, it still has some interest now, if you look back on it, some values. We shall see in another 25 or 30 years' time what stands the test of time from today. I think that'll be interesting.
Will you be up here on stage in 25 years' time?
Well, I'm not going to be banging my head and whatever. That'd be just too embarrassing for everyone. But I think, as I said earlier, the influences that we had when we were kids are broadly based. And so we find that the music is not only hard rock, but it's also gentle. You know, when we were listening to music, Buddy Holly and the Everly Brothers were just as important in rock terms as Fats Domino and Little Richard and Elvis Presley. And their music was very gentle and very soft. And I think there's an awful lot of room in rock for emotion and dynamics and texture and color. And I think the more control you have over the the dynamics, the more strength and power you're going to generate. I mean, one of the things about Purple is that they always held back and had the power under control, even though they were reputed to be the loudest band in the world. I think that was just an accident.
And we see the speakers around us.
We just got a small rig in today.
Yeah, they assure us that these are the largest speakers they've ever had here in Valby-Hallen.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's only because most of them don't work, I think.
Okay. You had to sing Purple songs. You had to fit into this unit. How about your solo career? Will you resume on that later on, or?
Yep. I've got about 3 projects at the moment which are nearing completion, all of which I'm very excited about. I don't want to start waving flags yet because it's too soon to talk about, but I'm very busy with other projects at the moment. And as soon as this particular Purple thing is taking a break or stopping for a while, then I've got more work than I know how to fit in, yeah.
But do you think that Purple will only be breaks, that you'll be joining the band from time, the band will be together from time to time?
Well, I hope so. I think that's the way it should go now, because it's always, if everyone takes it so seriously,
yeah,
and if it's just as the only thing in our lives, as a career, then I think the focus is too sharp, you know, and I think we need to relax and enjoy ourselves a little more. And as I said earlier, the race is over now. Let's just enjoy it and let's just accept what Purple is without... I don't think it's necessary to compete, you know? I never subscribe to the Rock Olympics. Who can play louder, sing higher, play faster and all that sort of thing? That never had much interest for me. But the histrionics of rock are well documented, and they are, of course, a part of it, the show side of it, you know, the drama side of it, the theatrical side of it. It's very passionate, and I think people want to see that. But there's another side too. There's an intimacy that people want to be touched as well in other ways. I like to. I'm a rock fan. That's why I'm here. That's the number one reason why I'm doing it. It's because I love music. So we should see.
Thank you.
you made no secret about, and Ritchie speaks about it, that, I mean, being together for so many years, of course, people do get tired of each other within the band, and there might be frictions every once in a while.
Mm-hmm.
But not larger than you can sort them out, or what?
They're normally much larger than we can sort out, yes. They're normally enormous. I think that it would be provocative or inflammatory to say, to go into any great detail at the moment, but let's say that it's always been difficult working with Ritchie. I don't know what goes on in his mind. I used to worry about it, but I don't anymore.
Not after all these years?
No. He's just weird.
Okay. But he's some demon on stage, isn't he?
Well, yeah, when he chooses to be, he's great. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd like to see Purple expand a little more in terms of dynamics and texture. I'd like to see John Lord more involved in the creative side. I'd like to see the band stretch out a little more. Not in panic, but in joy. But I would say this album has a direction. Certainly the production is a vast improvement on anything I've been involved with in Purple before. And I think the production gives a platform for the songs. Some of them I'm very pleased with. One Man's Meat, Solitaire, The Battle Rages On, Anya, and Ramshackle Man, and Twist in the Tail. I like all those songs very much indeed.
Okay.
Got it.
The way you talk about Purple now being so positive seems that there still are some years ahead within
one
the band.
One way or the other.
Yes.
Maybe.
Okay, Ian.